Good afternoon, and thank you for attending SkeptiCamp. Before we get to superintelligence, I want to begin by recalling a revolutionary event that happened over a century ago. There were a number of influential men in the late 1800s who said it was impossible to build a flying machine. But only a few years later, in 1903, the Wright brothers demonstrated that it was indeed possible to build a flying machine. Not only was it possible, but in fact, it was inevitable. Had the Wright brothers not done this, somebody else surely would have, and probably only a year or two later. The airplane was an idea whose time had come, and nothing could stop it. This is likely what will happen with the creation of superintelligence. Some people may say it's impossible, but in fact, it is far more likely that it is inevitable. With the invention of the airplane, humans finally built a machine that could do what birds do naturally. And we use the same terminology in both cases. Birds fly and planes fly. But what about building a machine that can think, like humans do naturally? In 1997, world chess champion Garry Kasparov was defeated by the IBM supercomputer Deep Blue. We say that Kasparov's chess-playing ability is an example of intelligence, whereas Deep Blue's ability is artificial intelligence. The term artificial is accurate, meant to distinguish it from the natural intelligence of humans. But the word artificial has multiple meanings, and it could be taken to mean that humans have real intelligence, whereas the computer has fake intelligence. But when a computer beats you at chess, there's nothing fake about it. The term artificial intelligence, or AI, has stuck, but I prefer the terms human intelligence and machine intelligence. Airplanes do not flap their wings, nor do they have feathers, yet they fly anyway. Humans and machines think very differently, but that doesn't mean that they are not both intelligent. Another triumph of machines over humans came in 2011, when IBM's Watson beat the best Jeopardy players, Ken Jennings and Brad Ryder. When Jennings saw that defeat was inevitable, he added this humorous quip to his final Jeopardy answer. Then, in 2016, the game of Go was next to be dominated by machines. Google's DeepMind division created three different versions of AlphaGo. The first two versions, AlphaGo Lee and AlphaGo Master, were both trained to play Go with a database of games played by humans. Then, AlphaGo Zero was created, and unlike its predecessors, AlphaGo Zero was not trained using any historical games. Instead, it was simply given the rules of Go and learned by playing itself. In 3 days, it achieved AlphaGo Lee performance, and in 3 weeks, it equaled AlphaGo Master. In 6 weeks, it was unbeatable. It did not need any human-supplied heuristics or any human-played example games to become the best Go player in the world. So what is intelligence, anyway? There are many possible definitions, but the simplest is that intelligence is the ability to accomplish goals. Note that this does not imply anything about consciousness. By this definition, machines can be intelligent even if they lack consciousness. Intelligence and consciousness are normally found together in humans, but with machines, they can be uncoupled. Superintelligence is short for superhuman intelligence, meaning intelligence far beyond human level. Think of human skills as existing on a landscape, where the submerged areas represent skills where machines have exceeded humans. Some things, like the ability to perform arithmetic and to memorize information, have been underwater for a long time. At one time, people were employed to perform arithmetic calculations, and those people were called computers. Since then, machines, which were also called computers, have taken over this task, and the humans that were previously employed as computers had to seek higher ground. More recently, machines have beat the best humans at playing chess, Jeopardy, and Go. Then there are the areas near the shoreline. These are tasks that both humans and machines can do, but skilled humans are still better than machines. But the water level is rising, and it may not be long before the low-lying areas are submerged. On the higher ground, we find the abilities that machines do not yet possess. This is a safe haven for humans for now, but the rising water level will eventually not spare even the highest peaks. This will be incredibly disruptive. Not only will many people be unemployed by this relentless rising tide, but many people will be unemployable. You've undoubtedly seen this in your web browser at some point. It is called a CAPTCHA, which is an awkward acronym, which stands for Completely Automated Public Turing Test to Tell Computers and Humans Apart. You may not have seen one like this in a while, because in order to make it too hard for machines, it is necessary to crank up the level of difficulty so high that humans often fail the test. I'd have some difficulty passing this particular human test. So it is now more common to see CAPTCHAs like this one that ask you to identify the squares that contain a particular object, because for the moment, this is still much harder for machines than it is for humans. But expect these to get more difficult over time, to the point where humans start failing again. By the way, although this test is ostensibly to prove you are human, they could be used surreptitiously to train an AI system to recognize objects. So if you see a CAPTCHA like this one, just click skip. No need to train up Skynet. By the way, Linda Hamilton will be returning as Sarah Connor in a new Terminator movie produced by James Cameron, and this is scheduled for release in November 2019. So what about the progress of machine intelligence? Right now, we are slowly adding capabilities to make smarter machines. But at some point, when machine intelligence rivals our own, a big change happens. When machine intelligence has achieved sufficient competence, we can hand off the task of making future improvements to the machines. Then begins rapid cycles of recursive self-improvement, and it leads to an exponential intelligence explosion. This event has also been called the singularity, because after this point, our ability to predict the future breaks down. All bets are off in a world where superintelligence suddenly exists. The late Stephen Hawking once said that this will be either the best or worst thing ever to happen to humanity. Indeed, this could be the most significant event ever to happen in human history. It will cleave history into the pre- and post-superintelligence eras. Here's a comic from the website waitbutwhy.com that illustrates the situation that we may find ourselves in. After years of patiently waiting for a human-level AI to arrive, we find that it never stops at the human-level intelligence station and only goes whooshing by, picking up speed. There are a number of misconceptions that I'd like to dispel. The first is that AI is inherently safe and only Luddites would worry about it. But the fact is, many intellectuals are ringing the alarm bell, and rightfully so. The second myth is a common trope in science fiction, that AI becomes dangerous when it becomes malevolent, conscious, or both. But to become dangerous, AI merely has to have goals that differ from ours, because superintelligence will be so incredibly good at achieving those goals. This next myth also comes to us from science fiction, that only AI embodied in robots is a threat, because otherwise it would be powerless to do things in the real world. But actually, AI can be dangerous if it has an internet connection. The AI can simply get people to do what it needs, no robots required. And this is a very common myth. Some say that AI could not pose a danger, because if it did, we'd simply hit the off switch. But there are good reasons why we might not be able to simply turn it off. For one, a superintelligence may use its overwhelming intelligence advantage to stop you. Alternatively, we may have grown dependent on the system and switching it off could be catastrophic for us. Some say that superintelligence is just a few years away, or alternatively, that it will take centuries. This is something that experts disagree on, so we don't know what the timeline is. But most of the guesses land somewhere between 2030 and 2100. This is within the expected lifetime of someone who is born today, and quite possibly within the lifetime of people in this room. Arthur C. Clarke once said that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. I think this could reasonably be extended to any sufficiently advanced intelligence is indistinguishable from God. The creation of superintelligence may indeed be inevitable, and if so, we need to ask ourselves the question, what kind of God do we want? Time does not permit me to go into greater depth on this fascinating topic. I'd highly recommend these books, Superintelligence by Nick Bostrom and Life 3.0 by Max Tegmark. I'd like to end with another Terminator reference. The future is not set. There is no fate but what we make for ourselves. Thank you for your attention.